Whoa. Okay. This is a bit of an emergency post that I was not planning on making, but my God, I have to do it. So I didn't at first want to go episode by episode reviewing each episode of The Last of Us, and I said episode a million times there, but I'm keeping it in. Today we're going to be talking about The Last of Us episode 3, Long, Long Time, which is the big and triumphant, I guess, introduction of Bill and Frank and their story, which was altered pretty much in every single way from the video game into the show. And my God, the amount of controversy first, before I even get into my feelings, the amount of controversy in this episode is just through the roof. And it's from many different reasons, whether it being video game nerds freaking out that it's an insane deviation from the comics, or whether it be really Sigma guys who are just anti-gay and all of that stuff, whatever. There's just so much hate out there from a lot of ways, but there's also so much love. I fall in the love category. I absolutely loved this episode. And this episode, both like the first and the second, just proved that this show is an absolute banger masterpiece. And it stands on its own, separate from the video games. And my God, man, there is not enough good things to say about this episode. Let's start from the beginning. The beginning, we start to see this episode, we don't have any time jumps back in the past to see what happened in the beginning. We just jump right into Joel and Ellie and their story and adopting what happened after the fallout of Tess in the last episode. And it picks right up with that. And you automatically start to see Joel and Ellie forming a bond. And it is a great introduction on the way to Bill and Frank's. And then, you know, we see some really cool stuff there. We see the plane crash, which was an iconic shot that we all knew about from the beginning of the promos of the show. We got to see that. We got to see the backstory of the people who were on their way to the quarantine zones, the QZ, and, you know, how some of them didn't make it because the government basically shot them down, literally, and things like that. We got that introduction, and we got that story. We got the confirmation that Cordyceps really came from the flower, which was a big confirmation because there was a lot of people thinking that online, and I was one of the people who thought that was a possibility. I didn't talk about it in a video, but the whole time I was watching every other YouTuber like, huh, that makes sense. So yeah, I'm not claiming any responsibility for that or anything like that, but it's cool that we got that confirmation. But all of that, while it was really cool, it doesn't even matter compared to the story that was told of Bill and Frank. And this is what I want to talk about in this video, because instead of just reviewing the episode, I want to talk about how you do a adaptation. How you just straight up do it. There are many shows and many mediums that try to adapt things, right? We have movies trying to adapt books, trying to adapt video games. We have movies trying to adapt comics. We have TV shows like The Walking Dead, Punisher, and many others trying to adapt comics and things like that. And this feels like the first, which is so ironic because video game adaptations are historically terrible. But this is the first adaptation I've ever seen, and we're only in 3 episodes, but this is the first adaptation where it can deviate from the original source material and just be so unbelievably good. Bill and Frank, the story that they told here of them, where Bill was this amazing prepper, and it was so fun to follow because you know people like that who really are paranoid, who are conspiracy theorists and things like that. You know people like that exist. So to see it kind of told in the way they did in this show, and to have Nick Offerman be playing it just so well, because we're so used to him playing in Parks and Rec and some other roles, we're not used to seeing him in this light. So when you see him, it's just jaw-dropping. And not that that matters for the adaptation's sake. I did want to just include that because it is relevant. But you start with him hiding, I guess you should say, at first, and then on the run, going to Home Depot, going everywhere to loot, to find stuff to bring back to his town because he realizes that everyone just left. It's just me. And he makes this amazing fortress of a home, of a little town. And it is just so amazing to follow. So you automatically have that cool element, which obviously was not in the video games at all to begin with. We never got this origin story. So we didn't even know what Frank looked like to begin with. But anyway, we get to see all of that. We get to see him build up, you know, fortify, protect his home and all of that stuff. And that was so awesome. It was so fun. The music, the sequence, everything already just so different and just works so well on the TV medium. Like just beyond belief. It looks great. It's better than anything I've seen in The Walking Dead. And I know that's a pretty crazy claim, but I am dead serious. These three episodes are up there, but this solidifies, this is a one-off episode. This is a bottle episode is what it really was, because Bill and Frank, they're never really going to come around again unless there's a little flashback or whatever. This was a bottle episode on two characters who don't matter, which we've seen in other adaptations like The Walking Dead, but this one was just so compelling from start to finish. Every minute was like, oh my God, I just want more of it. And then after all of the already good juicy stuff that we got with Bill and seeing him build up, then we get the introduction of Frank, and their story is just magnificent. From start to finish, when Bill sees him on the sensors, he sees Frank in the hall on the sensors, and then he goes to meet him, and you automatically see this connection. It automatically tells this story that is like one of the most beautiful love stories ever. And I know, like I said in the beginning, there's a lot of homophobic people out there that automatically have not, and they've been vocal about it. They don't like this episode because it's a love story between two men, and that is just ridiculous. If that detracted you from this episode, you have many other things in life to worry about. That's a whole other thing. The point I'm making here is it was just such a beautiful story with the two of them. Doesn't matter creed, color, whatever, it doesn't matter. It was a beautiful, beautiful story from start to finish. It was amazing to see them fall in love in the beginning. You got to see Nick Offerman play this vulnerable role that you've never seen him do before. You really haven't, especially if you're coming from Parks and Rec, where he literally played someone who doesn't like gayness and things like that. So you get to see this, and it's an immediate like plot twist to what we already know. Sorry about my dog barking in the background if you hear it, but I gotta say, just to see that vulnerability take over Nick Offerman and create something so amazing with this beautiful dynamic between him and Frank's actor, whose name I forget. I know he's in White Lotus, but I can't remember. And then their story of falling in love and their story of them fighting. And then the awesome pact that they made at the end that really, I guess, Frank wanted. And then Bill followed along where they basically committed together. It was just so beautiful. It was like out of the movie Up. It was like that sequence in the beginning of the movie Up with the main old man and his wife. It was like that, but for a whole episode. And I didn't want it to end because it was just done so well. You never see happy moments like that in an apocalypse story. And I know other creators are talking about this, but it's absolutely true. It was just told so well, and none of it happened in the game. And that is great. And the point I want to get into, because I just want to wrap up the story really quickly, but the point I want to get into in the future in a minute is that this is the prime example of how you complement what was already there in the source material, and you realize, hey, this didn't really work in the game that well. Why don't we expand upon that? And that's in part because Neil Druckmann and Craig Mazin are working on this, so you have inside people from The Last of Us, and I'm not saying both of them are, but you know what I mean, but you have inside The Last of Us writers working on the show, which is such an important element. Like, it really is such an important element, because the writers, unlike something like The Walking Dead, right? The Walking Dead, Robert Kirkman just had the rights to The Walking Dead purchased off of him. So he was just kind of the face of The Walking Dead. He didn't really have any say. Of course, they went to him for stories and things like that, for opinions and yada yada. But from a merit standpoint and all that, he didn't really have much value. Here, you have that value built immediately in to the production staff, like immediately built in, which is so unbelievably important, because you have these very important creative decisions being made. Like the deviation of Bill and Frank from the game, to the show. You have that just built in because it works, because the writer of the game was like, you know what? I didn't really like what we did here. I think there was room to improve this. And honestly, Bill doesn't really matter in the story overall. So why don't we just change it completely and complement what was already there and still drive the same narrative along? The whole point of that narrative in the end of the day was to get Joel and Ellie to come together more, because Joel wants to protect Ellie essentially. And really, the overarching point, even on top of that, is that they just needed the car off of Bill. Like that's what the story was. And that's the same story that was in the games. It's just in the games, you kind of knew Bill was still out there. Here we have a definitive answer, and it was done just so brilliantly, just so absolutely brilliantly. The story they told was beautiful. It was a movie in and of itself. And like I said, I wish we got more of it. This was already over an hour long, and I wish we had more there because it was just told gorgeously. It really was. Nick Offerman deserves an award for this role, and so does the other actor. I think his name's Murray something. I'm not sure. I can't remember what his name is. I listened to the podcast, but I forget what they said his name was. I can't remember. Both of them did a fantastic job, but specifically here, not that one was necessarily like better than the other, but Nick Offerman, because you never see him in this role, it was just so amazing to see. It was shocking, and it worked so unbelievably well. So that was a big highlight. For sure. And then, like I mentioned, you just have this compliment on top of it where the writers deviated so far from what was the original source material. Yeah, Bill and Frank were in the game and all of that stuff, but this is a totally different story. But guess what? You get the same outcome. You get the same narrative driving force forward, but what you get is a compliment to the game here, and you get a much better story, like a much better. And like I said a little bit ago, some people had problems with it, obviously for stupid reasons like the homophobic stuff and stuff like that, but some people also had a problem with it because they thought it was boring. I don't know what world you're living in. This is not a zombie show in the same way that like The Walking Dead was. That's not what this show is about. This show is a drama, just happens to be in the apocalypse. And for that, if you're watching thinking it's going to be the reverse and you're going to get scenes like the Raiders that was in this episode where you had Bill and Frank fighting those Raiders coming in and stuff like that, you're not watching the right show. At least so far, that's not what this is building up to be. And I hope, for the love of God, the rest of this season and the renewed season 2 that was just announced, I hope they follow this. And if I'm going to give major spoilers in a moment for the video game, for The Last of Us Part 2, and for the major characters in the series. So just skip ahead to the point I'm going to put up right here. Skip ahead to that if you want to skip over this major spoiler. But I really hope they don't mess up big moments like Joel's death in The Last of Us Part 2. I truly hope they don't. And if they write that in and they justify it well and it's told beautifully, I am okay with it. I just don't want to see them mess it up, because so far in 3 episodes that we already have, it's just done so well. This trajectory, I'm scared, is going to eventually plateau or get worse. I don't want that to happen, because right now it's on the up and up and up. Episode 1 was great. Episode 2 was a masterpiece. And episode 3 was another masterpiece. I don't know which of the two was better. I don't know if episode 2 was better. I don't know if episode 3 was better. They were both so tonally different, but they were both absolutely, absolutely, positively fantastic. Like, just beyond belief. So I hope they better not fuck this up. That's all I'm saying, because what we have is just so amazing. And if you're a writer and you want to adapt from a source material, this is how you do it. This is like the prime example of how you do it. You bring in people originally from the original writing staff, if you're so lucky to do that. And then from there, you don't fuck it up. They aren't fucking it up so far. And that's what makes this so amazing. Unlike something like The Walking Dead, where Scott Gimple was just basically a fanboy of the show and completely ran it in the dirt. And I'm sure AMC had a overall say of that too. But you could tell this show is just setting itself up to be something different. And that's what's amazing, is because the game set itself up to be something different. But this show is complementing it so well. It's not offensive to the game at all. And what it changes, what it deviates, is so complimentary and so amazing. I do not understand the hate for this episode. I understand some people love it, but the people that do hate it, I do not understand it. If you didn't like it, I'd love to hear about it in the comments. So please let me know. Can't wait to start a very healthy discussion about this episode here. So with that out of the way, thank you again so much for watching this video. And I will be covering, now that I'm so obsessed with it as it is, I will be covering The Last of Us episodically. So I will try to, if I don't get it out on the day, I will get it out within the week, hopefully. I know coming up, I'm going to be away on one of the days that one of the episodes, I think episode 5 will be airing. I will be in California, so I won't be able to post that night. But regardless, you will see videos from me reviewing these episodes, whether it's a live stream or whether it is a video like this. I just thought this episode was so good. It solidified. I am going to be covering it fully. I love this. And I just hope they don't mess it up. I really do. But with that out of the way, thank you again so much for watching this video. If you liked it, make sure you like it so we could share it with more people. Subscribe if you haven't already. And until the next one, I'll talk to you later. Peace out.